Hello, and a very warm welcome to the Insider Essay, your guide to living better. Join us today as we celebrate the theme of culture. Discover Chef Mogau Seshoene's new cookbook and its ability to bring cultures together. Visit a museum that is preserving artefacts and practices that remind us of the talent in us all. Meet Shirazee, an artist whose global upbringing has inspired his eclectic sound. See how designer Kathryn Mary Pichulik creates incredible pieces out of everyday materials. Learn how ceramicist Lookout Sibanda is on a mission to uplift those around him. Be inspired by Rina Chunga-Kutama's fashion that proudly displays her African heritage. And see how 67 Blankets is helping provide warmth to South Africans in need. Created by Chef Mogau Seshoene, the Lazy Makoti is a South African platform that celebrates food and its ability to bring people together. Mogau chose the South African Museum in Cape Town as the perfect place to connect with and be inspired by our history and culture.
It's amazing to see this documentation of traditions and culture and history. It speaks to my love for heritage and culture, and actually how I started the Lazy Makoti. I was working as an auditor, and I already had this love for cooking and for food and for heritage. And a friend of mine was due to get married, and she really wanted to impress her in-laws, and she would say they're going to call her the Lazy Makoti just because she can't cook. And I thought that that was funny and witty, and so yeah, I kept it as a name. From giving my friend these cooking lessons, it then evolved into opening up a studio, and that became what I do, literally teaching people how to make very simple, very delicious food from our heritage. I then decided to put it all in a cookbook, and that cookbook went on to become the best-selling South African cookbook. I think I owe the success of the cookbook to representation, 100%. I think it served a market that wasn't serviced. So a lot of people felt like finally they can see a cookbook that is speaking to them.
Paying tribute to the father of our nation, the Tata Madiba exhibition tells the story of the great man's life. From overcoming challenges to exploring the culture and traditions that informed his identity.
We're standing in the Madiba exhibition. It's called Tata Madiba, Father of Democracy, Father of Our Nation. And this was launched in July of 2018 by the Izika Museums of South Africa to celebrate International Mandela Day. In the center of the installation, we have the I Madiba sculpture, and this was the recreation of Madiba's cell on Robben Island. So it's the exact same size, and it's made into a bench, and this was done by the artist Ehart Thiel. People can sit in it while they're in this exhibition and basically have conversation with each other.
The Talking Heads and Heritage exhibition centers around ceramic masks made approximately 1,000 years ago during South Africa's Iron Age.
Many of the artifacts that you'll see here are actually linked to food production and the consumption of food. In terms of farming, we have implements that are made from metal. We even have a piece of burnt sorghum, which has been dated to around 1,000 years ago. This demonstrates to us that food is universal and cuts across cultures.
I love cooking because I feel like it connects me to my mother, my grandmother, my family. I think everybody loves food, but there's just something special about your mom's food or your aunt's food, food that's connected to memory and special moments. So that's why I love food. Now I'm feeling really inspired after that visit to the museum, and I'm going to be showing you how to make one of my favorite dishes from my culture. It's called Hodu in Sepedi and Topi in Venda, and I hope you'll enjoy it. So to make it, you need a few simple ingredients. You need some maize meal, some pumpkin, and my own little twist is some peanut butter. So traditionally it's made with some crushed peanut nuts, but today we're going to use some peanut butter and it'll be just as delicious. I'm gonna serve it with some berry kool-aid, and to make that you need any of your favorite berries, some sugar, some lemon juice, and then we're basically gonna stew those together, reduce it nice to a beautiful consistency, and we're gonna serve that with our hodu.
An exciting blend of fruit and vegetables brings together a colorful flavor combination, set to make this dish a winner.
In goes the butternut with just a little bit of water, just so we can steam it. We're gonna cook it until it's ready to mash. And then in here, I've got some boiling water so we can get our porridge started. So for the porridge, I'm just gonna pour a little bit of water to make a paste, and that's gonna help our porridge to not lump. Into the boiling water it goes, and that should be done same time as the butternut. Now let's make that berry kool-aid. This is really simple to make. In goes all of my berries and some sugar, as well as some lemon juice. This is actually my own twist. I really love to have this with some hodu. I love the sweetness of the berries on that porridge. So now we're just gonna let this cook until the fruit is cooked and reduced into a nice sticky sauce, and everything is gonna come together to make the most delicious snack you've ever had. For me, cooking is about taking simple, everyday, local ingredients and elevating them into delicious, simple meals that you and your family enjoy. It's about putting a little bit of your heritage on your dinner table.
With the final touches added, the dish is ready to be enjoyed. Beautifully presented in all its proud South African deliciousness.
As simple as that. Some quick homemade hodu served with my berry kool-aid. Delicious. So what does the future hold for the Lazy Makoti? Right now, I'm very happy to share that I'm working on my next cookbook. It's gonna be bigger and better. I'm adding in there a big celebration chapter. So everything Christmas, Easter, all the celebrations gonna be in there. I'm very excited for you to have it in your home, in your kitchen, to cook with it and hopefully to love it. But now I'm enjoying more delicious food.
We are privileged to live in a country where so many cultures come together to give us access to a unique culinary experience. The Lazy Makoti is a gem who reminds us of this great treasure. Coming up, discover South African artifacts at the Phansi Museum in Durban and hear how artist Shirazee is shaped by his African culture and upbringing. It's here in Glenwood, Durban, that we find the home of renowned architect Paul Mikula. With a deep appreciation for South African history and culture, Paul is the managing trustee of the Phansi Ubuntu Art Museum.
I collect something that we call Ubuntu art. And we believe in the museum that Ubuntu art saved our people to retain their dignity and to celebrate via the art.
The Phansi Ubuntu Art Museum is situated inside a Victorian-styled home where Esther Roberts, one of the first female social anthropologists, once lived. The museum is a tribute to South African heritage.
The mood of the museum is to make you feel good. It's a feel-good museum. When you go there, you come out feeling, wow! This incredible art, but you come out afterwards and you've got questions. You say, I want to know more about it. I want to learn how to do this. How can people make pots, these amazing pots, without having a kiln, without having a wheel, without having anything? So you'll find our outreach projects down there. We've got very good research facilities there. It's in order to answer those questions, to take it further. Because just to go there and say, hey, this is grand. It's a beginning. It should end somewhere. You should find your own genius.
The African Art Center grows emerging artists, providing workshops and platforms helping create business opportunities for local crafters.
We have to create a business opportunity for local crafters. ubusuhlala phansi ukuhlanganisa ninayit ubusuwakho ukhipha into shothi ngalithola mina ekhaya ngakhuluma akha umsebenzi wezandla nathi ke sakha kanjalo ke saqhubekela phambili.
In addition to being a museum, the space exists to build the local community and to both preserve the past as well as empower the future.
At Phansi Museum, we're having a big variety of artifacts that has been collected from different areas in Africa. This is called amabhaca in Zulu. These are grass mat holders which were used back in the days by Zulu people. This was made especially for the bride to take her grass mats to her in-laws. The number of mats are showing how wealthy family she's coming from. Here we're seeing the beautiful milk pail. We call them amatunga. Amatunga were used to get milk from the cow. When we look back in the days, the only way that was used to count how many cows that went out for grazing, how many cows came back on the same day, this is the method they were using. They were using these amantsumba wads to count. This is called the udongane. It's a carrying stick for a Zulu man. This shape here, it looks more like a marriage hat. So that tells us this man is married. If he's not married, he is ready. The dress code was very important because it identifies your status as well as your area. When we look at this mama, she's a Zulu married woman. She's wearing her marriage hat, which was made out of human hair and attached to her hair. It was non-removable. This is a pregnancy apron. We call it isiqwayo. It was worn by a married woman when she was pregnant for the first child. When the child was born, this was converted to a baby blanket to carry the baby.
The artifacts preserved at the Phansi Ubuntu Art Museum were created by ordinary people for everyday use. This is a beautiful reminder of the talent that lies in us all and of the importance of preserving our proud heritage. Musician Shirazee's global upbringing has empowered him with a sense of cultural awareness that, along with his musical talents, has shaped him into one of today's exciting artists to watch.
Well, listen, I grew up in Benin, West Africa, in between Benin, Ghana, South Africa, London, Paris, and then ended up in New York City. Now, where I am, African in New York, you get it. Man, my collaboration with Sting happened so organically. It just came from me just wanting to tell my story because I would meet people that would say, hey, I can't believe you're the guy that sang Make Wild, you're the guy that sang Soweto, you're the sign, and they didn't know who I was. So I thought, I have to make people relate to my story. So when I did African in New York, that's what led to the collaboration with Sting. And here we are, because he heard it, he gave me his blessing and asked for us to do a version together. I jokingly call my genre of music bipolar pop. What I mean by that is you can find a lot of different influences in my music. And my overall message is basically pushing Africa to the world sonically and doing it with pride so that everybody back home could look at me and be like, you know what, he's representing us properly. And I think that's incredible to even say out loud for a kid from Cotonou, Benin. Who would have thought? Growing up as a child in Benin was awesome. You know what I'm saying? Like, I had a mother that was raising a family by herself, but she did her best for us, and she made us feel like we had everything, even though she was, you know, struggling to put food on the table. But I think that's where I get my work ethic from watching her work so hard to do that for us. My relationship with South Africa is very, very interesting because I have deep roots with this place. I lived here for 4 years with my family before going to Paris and London and all these places. And always happy to come back and make music and spread the word. And always tell people, like, visit South Africa whenever you get a chance.
The trendy cultural hotspot of Mabuneng near the Johannesburg CBD is the perfect place for Shirazee to enjoy his favorite dish of fish with cheese sauce.
Wow, that looks good. Can't wait to dig in. Favorite food, there's acheke and poisson grillé. I love that. That's my favorite food. I got a plate of goodness right here. I got the hake, I've got the spinach, I got the traditional sampan beans on this plate. I'm in heaven.
To cater to his distinctive style, Shirazee has found a place in South Africa that shares his love for African prints that proudly show off vibrancy and culture.
Listen, we're in Randburg right now at Leo 84, where I get my jackets tailored when I'm in South Africa. Come with me. What's up, man?
How
are you? Everything good?
Yeah.
Look, man, you know why I'm here. Same thing, Shirazee jacket, but like just different pattern.
Okay, I see.
Something special, I got a performance coming up.
So, all right.
You know, you got me?
Yeah.
All right.
The jacket I'm making for Shirazee is African print jacket. It's a long cut. I choose the fabric for him because it's good quality. And it's gonna be suitable for him and type of jacket that he's looking for.
When I was coming up with my look, my identity, I always made sure that I represented where I was from and kept it in a way that the silhouette would always look iconic. So when you look at a silhouette, a Shirazee silhouette, you know what that is. It's the hat, the earring and everything. And It was thought through, you know, early on. So I'm just glad that now it's finally connected and people actually can identify the two when they see me. The way I dress complements my personality in a way that just speaks to the way I was raised, right? Like, I had a mother who always said, you know, wherever you go, carry yourself like a king. And it's always stuck with me. You know, it was never about money. It was never about what you had in the pocket. It's how you carry yourself and always be proud of where you're from. So I try to just take that and incorporate that in the fashion, and that's what you get. Man, right now we're in studio, as you can see, my favorite place. I call it my second home, actually my first home if I want to be real. The importance of collaboration for me, it's one of the primary ingredients to my sound and my music and my brand. Like, if you listen to my music, you can tell I've been influenced by so much. So it's just so no-brainer for me to go to different territories and be able to work with different acts and feel like right at home, all the while learning how to keep my voice as strong as possible so that I can be around for a long time. We want to be here forever, right? What I do hope people take away from my EP Lost is great music and an honesty that this is an artist who is trying to find himself, and we are just going along with the journey with him.
Shirazee says the biggest lesson he has learned is the importance of betting on yourself and not relying on others to do things for you. This sense of personal empowerment is sure to serve him well as he continues to share his unique perspective on culture with the world. Next on the Insider Essay, meet designer Kathryn Mary Pichulik and learn about the philosophy behind her pieces. And hear the inspiring story of ceramicist Lookout Sibanda, whose work is uplifting others. People have been making jewelry for as long as they have been making tools. Jewelry designer Kathryn Mary Pichulik believes we do this to remind ourselves that we are part of something greater. Establishing her brand of handcrafted pieces in 2012, she's inspired by transforming everyday materials into precious designs.
In 2012, I began playing with rope and different found objects. And in 2013, Pichulik was formed as an official business. It was a hobby that I would do in the evening. I'm a trained pastry chef, and also I've graduated with a Bachelor in Fine Arts at Michaelis. And I just started to make pieces in the evenings, and then I started to wear them, and then people would want to buy them off my neck. And then we started getting orders, and then we had to respond to those orders, and a business was formed.
Jewelry is a representation of culture. Incredible stories are held within the designs that have drawn inspiration from various interpretations of the world.
Pichulik is inspired by ceremony and initiation, and tracking the connections across the continents that bring us together. So what's really interesting about jewelry is it's a relic of the trade routes. It speaks of woman's relationship to her community. It speaks of all the different initiations she has throughout her life into womanhood. And that's a commonality that spans South America to North Africa, to the south of Spain, into Southern Africa. And I love that connection. Gloria Steinem says, we are not ranked, we are linked. And I think jewelry is an incredible link for women internationally and globally.
The materials used in the designs are all sourced from the continent, with the design pieces produced at their Cape Town studio. Their iconic ropes are made by local crafters and beautiful stones gathered across Africa.
This is where all of the Pichulik pieces are crafted and assembled and finished. It takes quite a lot of skill because everything is so finite and small. And here you are meeting some of our best teammates. Everything takes a lot of finesse and attention and intention, and some incredible color combinations. I think that's one of the things that we as of a brand are quite proud of, is we have fantastic color combinations, and there is a lot of refinement in the work that we do.
I've been part of the brand for 5 years, and I come from Zimbabwe. Working here, it's like, it's really part of family. It's something that is very amazing, because we're just like a group of women, and all of us, we're coming from different backgrounds, but we have learned from each other.
Kathryn Mary Pichulik believes in the value of empowerment. She says it's about encouraging self-actualization and making others reach their full potential.
The Pichulik woman is not a specific demographic. We like to say that she is rather a woman of a certain type of spirit. She is passionate about South Africa and Africa. She is inquisitive. She works on herself. She is kind. She's funny. She's daring. She's bold. And she often trends a little bit older. But we have also found that with new pieces that we released with our nascent collection, we're also starting to develop a younger, sassier audience. Each Pichulik piece, I feel, attracts a certain type of woman, and I almost feel it's like a pharmacy whereby a woman is attracted to the piece that she needs. And we feel that by wearing it, she's able to do some healing, because every single time you're putting on that jewelry, you are taking a moment to kind of bring sacredness to that ritual of like, yes, I am the storyteller. Yes, I am powerful. Yes, I am brave. Yes, I am enough.
Much of her work is concerned with ideas of upliftment and seeing the world from a pro-female perspective.
This collection is entitled Circe, and it's named after Homer's Iliad's character of Circe. And it's quite a beautiful story, because Circe was considered a little bit of the underdog in the narrative, a non-major kind of goddess in the Iliad story. And then through kind of the revisionist feminists of the 70s, they started to re-embody or give new life to these protagonists, whereby the woman becomes the heroine and the story is her story, and she's not just in the background. In this collection, mythology and folklore are really central to the story. The materials are monolithic. We're working with things like obsidian, with lava stone, so really kind of quite elemental and Vesuvius, to really kind of speak to this powerful female protagonist that is Circe. She was considered the original witch, but I think that is just in the framework of her being kind of a wild, defiant, powerful woman. But now we're imagining her as a healer, as a wisdom sharer, and also as a powerful heroine, which anyone woman can relate to and see themselves within.
Minimal and tasteful pieces can say so much about who we are. Kathryn Mary Pichulik's jewelry expresses our individual ideas about style and culture to the world. The story of successful ceramicist Lookout Sibanda is inspiring. This PE-based artist's talent has been molded by various mentors throughout his career. His journey has seen him building his own business, selling ceramic creations inspired by his culture.
My name is Lookout Sibanda. I was born in Zimbabwe. I realized that ceramics is something that I wanted to do sometime 2008-09 when I was in Pretoria working for Elsa van Dijk. I was painting ceramics, but that wasn't interesting. When I started to make, then that's when I started to understand ceramics. And you forming something and then painting it is actually a joy. I think that's when I actually figured out this is me. I didn't see myself doing anything else besides ceramics. I wanted to grow, so I moved to PE, eGqeberha, where I started my own business, Lookout Ceramics. The artists in the city are more supportive. When I first came here, I feel like I was more supported by the artists. So that is very good. There is no competition. We actually see each other as friends. It's been good. Sales are good, and I also do a few workshops here and there, and also exhibitions. Beauty means a lot of things, but to me, it means ceramics, color, and texture. I mean, color that draws you to the piece, and texture that says, come, feel me. And anyway, let me take you to the studio, and you see what I mean.
In 2015, he began working at Pret-a-Pot, a pottery store owned by Nicole Kingston. Since starting his own business, he has continued to manage his time between the two.
My style of ceramics is, I'll refer to it as unique. I use both white clay and black clay, and I put more texture and more color. At the moment, I prefer using the black clay. This red clay turns black when it gets to the kiln because of copper oxide that is in it. It actually works well for me because it shows more of the colors that I want to use, and it also shows the texture that I prefer using. I don't throw on the wheel. So what I do is I coil and I do slab work. So with coiling, what I'm talking about is you literally make coils like this, and you make as many coils, and then you join them together, and then you actually build up a pot from there. And then with the slabs, you can use a rolling pin or a slab roller like this one. And with the slabs, what you can do is you can either cut the form that you want, or you can put it on a mold slump. You know, the thing that I love about ceramics is that it's therapeutic. You know, I'm not a doctor or a nurse, but I think it is actually therapeutic, and I would, you know, advise someone who wants to, you know, to clear their mind to actually do ceramics. You can actually do classes where you can just play with clay and not just do anything. Just the feeling of clay alone is actually therapeutic. That's it, guys. This is going to take 1 or 2 days to dry. So while that is happening, let's do some painting. My part is mostly on texture and color. That's basically what I focus on. Because for you to pick up something, there must be something that draws you to that piece. And that is the color. And for you to actually want to touch it, that is now the texture. I make a lot of things. I make functional stuff and I make decorative stuff. And to be honest with you, the one that I really love making is the decorative stuff, because they sort of like represent who I am. You know, they have a message behind. They are sometimes inspired by what is happening around me or something that is happening all over the world. Mostly I focus on Africa.
Lookout Sibanda's shop is part of a collective space shared with other artists. The location is part of a vibrant function venue which frequently hosts events and live music.
Welcome to the home of Lookout Ceramics. This is where the magic is. Over here, you've got my functional stuff, and behind me, you've got your decorative stuff. And then from there, you come to this side where there is a little bit of functional and decorative pieces, including the chessboard that is called Leaders. It is very important to share and celebrate African art because I believe African artists in general, we make and paint our surroundings, what is happening at the moment. So whatever has happened is being recorded as we go. So it's basically recording history so that whoever follows afterwards can actually look at this and say, okay, this is what was happening in 2020. This is what was happening in 2021. This is what was happening in 1980. So we share the culture, we share the situations. That is the beauty of Africa at the moment that we are. It's just beautiful. You just have to look deeper beyond the struggles that we're going through to actually see the beauty of it. My hopes and dreams for the future is expansion, and I can employ more people rather than just part-time. That would be huge. And my other hopes is for the government to actually introduce life skills at an early age, introduce your ceramics, your visual painting, your woodwork. What is happening now is you get your wood turning, your ceramics when you get to university. So what about the people that finished at a lower level, so they can't get that? So we have to also instill that so that when you get to matric, if you can't go upwards, then you can actually use the skills to actually have your own business, at least earn a living, instead of trying to find employment that is not there. With starting your own thing, you can also provide employment. Thank you for visiting Krebs and the House of Lookout Ceramics. I hope you enjoyed what you saw.
Working with his hands, Lookout Sibanda's pieces are one of a kind. With his passion to pass on his skills, he's determined to grow his own business whilst developing talent in others. Coming up, meet a woman who built her fashion business out of her bedroom with deep connections to her Zambian culture. Fashion designer Rina Chunga-Kutama was born in Zambia, grew up in Botswana, and is now a resident in South Africa. Building her business with her husband Dimo Kutama, she's passionate about African cultural conservation through fashion, art, and storytelling.
Ri.Ch Factory was started in my bedroom when I was 17 years old, all the way in Polokwane. I was on my gap year, and my mom started teaching me how to sew. I did intend to go study fashion the next year, but yeah, it was my gap year. And I started sewing, and my cousin had her matric fail that year, and I made her dress. It was a hit. Everybody loved it. And next thing you know, I was making matric fail dresses for everybody. Once I went to tertiary, it was just a very natural way for me to make money while I was studying. So people like to refer to Ri.Ch Factory as an overnight sensation. It was not. From 2007 till 2016, I was working from my bedroom, wherever it is that I lived. And finally in 2016, I made the move into this shop right here in Parkhurst because the business had grown bigger than my house. It grew that big because I was dressing celebrities at the time. And of course, when they would post, people would get in touch with the brand and they really wanted it. And when I came into the shop, it made the brand more accessible because people didn't have to make an appointment to come into my house anymore. The doors of the shop were open when they were open. And now since last year when we opened our online store, it has grown even bigger because no matter where in the world you are, you can actually access the garments. You don't have to come to this one shop in Parkhurst in Joburg to get the stuff. My biggest fashion icon is Anna De La Russo. I really look up to her. She's a maximalist, which is exactly the kind of fashion that I love, where more is more. Over the last couple of years, it was all about minimalism, black, white, tan, a little bit of everything, a brown wall and a plant. But that's not what we do here. We want more. Give me more print, give me more color, give me more frills, the whole thing. I have two career highlights that I'm really proud of. My first one would be being on the Forbes 30 Under 30 list. I mean, for somebody who didn't really finish their qualification, who started a business in their bedroom, who comes from a small town like Polokwane. That was a big deal for me. My second one would be my 2019 fashion show. It was my third fashion show at Fashion Week. And that year I was really able to show who I really was as a designer. The whole show was spectacular. We thought about everything from lighting to the backdrop to the deco on the stage, and it really encapsulated my personality and the personality of the brand. This collection started in 2019 when I traveled to Bali, and I was inspired by the vacation looks. So this is Yaya, and she is wearing our Bali set. It is a two-piece top, but you can wear it two different ways. You can wear it from the front and the back, and a pair of flare pants with pockets to give you sort of that vacation vibe. This is Subatle. She is wearing our most favorite dress right now. It is the purple hibiscus dress. It is selling like hotcakes, and it's because it looks so regal. Where would one wear this to? Well, if you're a girl like me, you can wear it every day. But any special occasion, it has actually been the birthday dress of the year. So Butler is wearing our latest dress. You guys are actually getting an exclusive because it hasn't even been named yet. So you wore it first. And it's a winter dress, but we're gonna make sure that we are still having fun. We are still on vacation. We are still twirling and twirling. And on this side, Yaya is wearing our Luganga two-piece set. So it's a crop top with a gathered detail off shoulder and a little frill over here and a pencil skirt. So it's almost like it's a party up top and business at the bottom.
I absolutely love this collection. I love the feel, I love the cut, I love the playfulness of the print. And I also love the diversity because you can switch it up. You know, when we have to go play, we're ready to go play. But then when we have to go to the office, I can just, you know, wear the skirt and put on a white shirt and go to a meeting.
I just love the feel of the material. I love the different prints, the frills, the inclusion of all the pockets because they make it fun.
Right, girls so love really pockets. Love it, absolutely everything. Love it.
Beauty to me is when you are your most authentic self. I really believe that authenticity is the best way to go. I don't think anybody needs to look in a magazine and try to look like a certain standard of beauty. When you accentuate your own features, when you're confident in your own body, just you being yourself is the most beautiful thing.
Heading from work to home, Rina showed us how she's created a space for herself and her family to feel a sense of belonging.
Welcome to my home. As you can see, I have switched it up, new hair, comfortable dress. I have taken a lot of care into creating a house that is a warm, safe, healing environment. It's a shoeless house, so come on in. I've taken great care in creating a really beautiful home where I don't allow shoes. And the reason I don't allow shoes is because I'm really particular about energy. I want the energy in my house to be really peaceful and cleansing. The reason for that is because I'm healing from an autoimmune disease called lupus. Your immune system actually attacks your own body cells and it attacks the good cells, even though you are healthy. It's always having an immune response saying that you are ill. So it has attacked my skin, my hair cells, my organs like my kidney and my womb, which has led to infertility. Having an autoimmune disease like lupus, which affects my skin and my hair, and being in the fashion industry, which is such a visual industry, was something quite daunting for me. I really had to take the time to find how to be comfortable in my appearance. I was losing my hair and find ways that I could still be myself even without something that I was so connected to, which is how I got into my wigs and this green hair that I love so much. So I wear different kinds of wigs according to the mood I'm in. My wigs don't have names like most people, but I'd say I'd wear this one when I'm feeling a little fun. I don't wear wigs all the time though. I do wear my own hair despite the alopecia, and I'm definitely keen to show that off as well. So I know this isn't something people would be used to seeing on camera or even in the streets, but I do wear my own hair out. It's taken me a long time to grow this hair, so I proudly wear it out. I do enjoy my wigs, but sometimes I just wanna be myself, and I think I have a pretty face, so I don't always wanna be covered up with all of that hair.
Passionate about communicating and hearing other people's stories, as well as sharing her own, Rina launched Umfwa, a space for joy and conscious conversations.
So last year when lockdown happened and COVID happened, we had to close our doors, but I still wanted to continue these conversations. I still wanted to engage with my community and I still wanted to
chat with other artists and the people who would facilitate these workshops. So the podcast was just a natural way to go. Hello, lovers and friends. It's been a while since I checked in with you guys, and I am here recording on a sunny afternoon with the Insider SA. The podcast is very much based on my love for storytelling. I love to sit down in conversation with people and really find out about their journeys. We talk about healing a lot because I think that when you hear somebody's story, you don't always know how they got to where they are. So connecting those dots is very important, and we bring that a lot into the podcast.
When she married her longtime partner Dimo, their ceremony paid tribute to her Zambian as well as his vendor heritage.
This is my beautiful family. This is my husband Dimo.
And this is our beautiful baby girl Rainbow.
She's 10 months old. The parenting journey was quite a long one for us. We started the process of adoption in 2019 after struggling with infertility for a couple of years. And yes, we were finally blessed with this beautiful baby girl in 2021, 2 years later.
After every storm, there always comes a rainbow. And this is our beautiful rainbow in our lives.
The quality of my life has drastically improved since having a baby. So for one thing, Dimo and I, because we were just, you know, just the two of us, we used to order takeaways almost every night. And now when you have a baby, that's just not an option. So we cook, we stay at home, we have more family time in the house. We go out to the park and do things like that. Life has just definitely gotten better.
Yeah, and I think also for us, her presence has helped us communicate more, which is so amazing. And you cut down on a lot, man. You cut down on social life.
Home life becomes very
home important. Life, yeah. Home life becomes everything, actually, you know, because even when you're out running work errands, all you want to do is just be home with your family. I mean, who could blame? I mean, look at that smile. You'd always want to be around it, right? Yeah!
Rina Chunga-Kutama's work with Dimo and the Ri.Ch Factory is helping keep culture alive through her passion for telling a uniquely African story. Coming up, see how Capitec and 67 Blankets are helping provide warmth to South Africans in need.
Simplify banking. Live better with Capitec.
At an event held at the Women's Jail Museum at the iconic Constitution Hill, Capitec CSI team held a crochet-a-thon aimed at encouraging volunteering and celebrating their employees who selflessly give their time to better our communities. Capitec and their staff again showed their support by crocheting blankets and encouraging fellow South Africans to make a difference.
Welcome to the Capitec Crochethon. We are here at Constitution Hill in Gauteng. The aim of the day is to honor the Gauteng region. We have over 130 staff members from Limpopo, from the north, the east, the west. They have embraced the Hooked on Helping project as volunteers. And today we are thanking them for what they have done.
This was an initiative by one of our employees that spread to a lot of other employees that crochet within Capitec. As a business, we wanted to get involved in communities, but also we wanted to provide our employees an avenue to get involved within the communities that they live in, that we also work in. So this was a wonderful, wonderful opportunity, and not just to get involved, but to be part of those, because crocheting is a very unique activity because people invest themselves. And when they say we give with love, that's exactly what crocheting does.
Employees from across the country have pledged their time to hand make warm blankets as part of Capitec's Hooked on Helping initiative in partnership with 67 Blankets. The former prison was chosen as the venue for this occasion to highlight South Africa's cultural heritage.
Celebrating in Constitution Hill is fantastic. It's outside, it's COVID friendly. It means people can get together to do what they do best, which is what 67 Blankets for Nelson Mandela Day is about. And Capitec on board with this is fantastic. As you can see, everybody's sitting outside, knitting, crocheting, and part of what we do at 67 Blankets and what Capitec is doing as well is about knitting lives together. It's about knitting our country together again.
We are at the Constitution here, and this place signifies what women of South Africa have done for us to enjoy the freedom that we are enjoying today. But also it speaks about the freedom of expression. And for us is how our own people, our employees, can express themselves through volunteering and expressing through crocheting blankets. We are really encouraging our employees and creating this awareness that giving is good, not only for the receiver, but for the giver as well.
I think it's very important for South Africans to honor our history, and I think it's quite emotional being here at the women's jail, knitting and crocheting, because it makes us remember a journey that we've come on for the last few decades. It makes us remember what people went through, and it's up to us to make changes and to make a difference, and that's what all these people are doing here today. So it's quite a healing process maybe for some people to be here, and maybe it's the first time that people have been here and have been able to experience this part of our history.
This living museum tells the story of South Africa's journey to democracy. Guest speaker Mogau Molefe was one of those imprisoned at the women's jail.
Where I'm standing now is a privilege, because what happens is that when we were in there, we never saw the whole prison. We were confined to your cell only when you go out, maybe when they take you to John Foster, and when you go for exercising. I only saw this place now. I never wanted to come here because it had such memories. But now, because I'm coming often, I'm feeling better. And especially when I bring people to come and see where we passed, because we passed here for this country to be where it is today.
I started crocheting last year, and the reason for that was because I had just had a miscarriage. It took a huge toll on my life because it wasn't the first miscarriage that I got. So I started crocheting for therapy. As I started teaching the team members in my area, for them, they were able to use their time to touch other people's lives, putting their time out there, volunteering to sacrifice so that they can help someone. Keep them warm in winter with a blanket.
Providing the entertainment on marimba were the Outreach Foundation Band from nearby Hillbrow. Due to the support this organization provides to the community, Capitec chose to give blankets to the foundation on the day.
The Outreach Foundation is in the heart of Hillbrow. We work with vulnerable communities, migrant communities. We're also working in schools in the inner city of Johannesburg, doing a learner support program and a life skills program. So the blankets will go out into these communities, and we're going into winter. So I think people will be warm and will be held by these blankets. The marimba, the music program, has been right at the beginning of the foundation, but it's not only about creating artists, it's about extracurricular activity for young children, youth, to explore what it is to be part of a team, to be part of a program that gives them confidence, gives them skills, gives them a sense of self-worth, which has been so important over the last year during COVID-19.
To our clients out there, when they go to our branches, especially from autumn going into winter, we'd have those boxes in the branches. Go and donate wool. It's a good way to give, because there's a lot of people that are out there during winter that are cold, that need those blankets and the woolies that we create. So to our clients, please, I urge you to donate the wool.
The whole point of today is to really challenge everyone to say, you've got power within you. It starts with an individual. Any person can really make a change that will change the course of this country. And you have the power. If it's not the resources, it's the time that you can use to better the life of the next person.
You can contribute toward making beautiful blankets that will keep someone warm this winter. Join the Hooked on Helping family by donating wool the next time you visit a Capitec branch. Balls of wool, knitted squares or blankets can be left in the boxes placed in each branch. All contributions will be allocated to the Hooked on Helping volunteers and 67 blankets, who have for this year embarked on crocheting blankets for vulnerable children and abused women. Hashtag Capitec, live better. For more information on the incredible guests and stories featured in today's show, head over to theinsidersa.co.za. Join us again next week as we explore the theme of beauty.
Another feel-good production.